Time having arrived, I call this meeting of the Brockton School Committee to order, and I invite you to please rise and join me in the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Thank you. So our first order of business at a school committee meeting is hearing of visitors. That's an opportunity for members of the public to address the school committee, the superintendent, and myself on any topic or issue. There is a 3-minute time limit that we ask you to please adhere to, and all matters are taken under advisement by the school committee. There's no immediate response from the school committee, but all issues raised will be carefully considered. At this time, we will bring speakers up. We have two speakers. We'll bring them up in the order they signed in. Our first speaker is Richard Bennett.
Thank you for allowing me to speak today. My name is Richard Bennett. I have worked as a teacher at the Brockton High School for 6 years. On Monday, I sent letters to each of you to address my concerns about the current direction of the school, and I felt it was important for me to come in person to address these issues publicly. Last week shocked all of us into asking hard questions about our school's discipline policies. But as we move forward, we must first acknowledge that the problems we face are not isolated to these events. The implementation of the new educational law, referred to as Chapter 222, has resulted in extraordinary changes to our discipline policies at the high school. As a result of this law, it is true that we have greatly reduced suspension rates, and although some may see this as a victory, we must look more closely at exactly how we have achieved these reduced rates. We have not lowered suspension rates by reducing actual behavior problems, but rather by simply reducing enforcement of basic rules and by applying fewer consequences. As a direct result, we have experienced a school-wide breakdown in discipline over the last 2 to 3 years, which culminated in the large-scale outbreak of violence we experienced last Thursday and Friday. But now we have to ask ourselves, did Chapter 222 really force us into such a desperate circumstance? Just how severely does Chapter 222 restrict our ability to deal effectively with behavior problems? I've read this law carefully, and I see nothing in it that justifies what I have seen at the high school. Chapter 222 does not prevent meaningful consequences for students who cut or are tardy to class on a consistent basis. It does not prevent meaningful consequences for students who use profanity towards other students or towards staff members. It does not force us to tolerate students who threaten or verbally abuse teachers. It does not require us to suffer the behavior of students who regularly disrupt the learning environment. Nor does it force us to ignore the flagrant violation of our district's cell phone and headphone policies. And it certainly does not prevent us from consistently giving long-term suspensions to students who act violently and pose a danger to our students. So why under Chapter 222 have we radically reduced our enforcement of these basic policies? Why have we experienced the exponential growth of behavior problems that were virtually non-existent 3 years ago? That's a question I will leave for the school committee to investigate and to find answers for. For now, I would simply like to close with an earnest plea on behalf of my students. We have a professional, legal, and moral obligation to provide them with an orderly, efficient, and safe learning environment. We must not fail them. Thank you.
And our next speaker is Kimberly Gibson.
Good evening, Mayor Carpenter, Superintendent Smith, school committee members. First of all, I do need to thank you all for the work you did all summer long with this tough budget that we've had. We recognize that you've made some tough decisions throughout that time. I have to say, the events that came about of last Thursday and Friday were a shock to everyone. I do believe we're in a point where we need to come together and figure out a solution for this. I met with the staff up here at the high school this afternoon and administrators. There is a common theme. They are looking for some direction. They're looking for better communication. They're looking for safety. In the 7 years that I've been president, I've never come before you and pleaded for some things to be put back into one level while looking at other levels and not asking for that. The high school needs some things put into place immediately. I believe you'll be making some decisions tonight, which will be hard because other levels will suffer because of it. Staffing needs to be added back up at this high school. When we bargained that contract, we bargained it with a much larger staff size. It was not intent to cut staff at all. That is what has happened. We are now seeing the ramifications of that, regardless of the budget. We have to find the money someplace. We have people who are willing to go above and beyond. They're being burnt out at this point. You have people who want to make this high school great again. It's a level one school. A small number of students caused this last week. The majority of students want to be here. I know all of you have had conversations. I saw the next day Superintendent Smith up at the high school. I know the mayor was there. I saw Tom Minicello up there. I believe you are invested in this. I just have to say to you, I think that unless we work together, this will not become any better. The teachers and the administrators up here all want to make this a safe place again, where students feel safe, where teachers feel safe. I've never had teachers call me to say, you know what, I don't feel safe going to high school. Last Thursday, that changed. And that's very concerning because not only were they advocating for themselves, but their students. Some people in the school have students who are their children. Their children came home on Thursday and Friday upset. I know you don't take it lightly. I just cannot emphasize enough. I get the budget. I understand it's tough. We have to work together to fix this. I look forward to talking to Superintendent Smith tomorrow. We have a meeting scheduled where I will share what was shared with me through staff and administrators on things to improve. I've spoken to Mike Thomas this evening to also talk with him about some things. There are safety concerns as simple as equipment not working in classrooms, speakers not working, telephones not working. I don't know how that can be when it's a simple request from staff. They should be going to their administrators. For some reason, they don't right now. And we have to fix that. So thank you all for your time. I understand it's a difficult budget season, but I really think you need to look at what was bargained almost 2 years ago now and really put things back in place at this high school to make it safe and to make the education top-notch again. Thank you all.
Thank you. Okay, our next order of business is the consent agenda. This is the manner in which the school committee handles a number of items of routine business as one block in order to keep the meeting moving along. However, before we vote on the consent agenda, any member of the school committee may request that an individual item be removed from the consent agenda for individual discussion and deliberation. So at this time, I would ask, do any members of the committee have a specific item that they would like removed from the consent agenda? Hearing none, I'll entertain a motion.
Motion to accept the consent agenda.
Motion's been made, seconded by Mr. D'Agostino. All in favor? Approved unanimously. So at this time, I'll turn the meeting over to our Superintendent of Schools for her report on teaching and learning.
Thank you, Mayor Carpenter. Before we begin, I see that we have a new face here this evening. We are so thrilled to have our student representative. I'm going to let her introduce herself to start. It's a name that's difficult to say. I'm going to get very used to it. So could you introduce yourself? Is it Somata?
Somto.
Somto. Can you introduce yourself and tell us a little bit about yourself?
Okay. Good evening, everyone. My name is Somto Anabog. I'm a senior at Brockton High School. I'm a new member of this committee and also student council. And I'm also a member of the freshman mentors. May I start with my...
Please, share with us your information.
You've got the floor.
So, as we've discussed, there were some very unfortunate incidents at Brockton High last week. I want everyone to know that these incidents do not represent the spirit of Brockton High. We, the student body, uphold a culture of respect, responsibility, and maturity. The actions of some individuals has not changed this. We will continue to uphold this culture. In lighter news, this Thursday is early dismissal at 11 a.m.
That's right.
There will be faculty meetings in the afternoon. On Friday at 7 p.m., Brockton High is playing a home football game against Severian High School. This will be our first home halftime show featuring the marching band in the majorettes. Next Wednesday, October 12th, first term progress reports will be sent home with students, and parent-teacher conferences are Thursday the 20th. College fairs will continue this month on the 5th, the 12th, the 19th, and the 25th. College fairs are an opportunity for students to speak with representatives from different colleges and universities. That is all.
What's the date of the college fair? What's the date of the college fair? I'm sorry.
The 5th, 12th, 19th, and the 25th.
Of 5th, 12th, 19th, 25th. Okay.
And we are so looking forward. I hear that you are a student that will express your opinion and share with us, you know, certainly some things that are happening up at the high school, and we really look forward to your presence here.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay. I'd like to start out by acknowledging the Lowe's Heroes project donation. Do we have representatives from Lowe's here? Please come up. Deputy Superintendent Thomas, can you? Karen, would you like to come up and share with us? Thank you. Come to the microphone.
Good evening. I have with me this evening Chad Gosher, pronouncing it right, our local store manager for the Lowe's Home Improvement Store. And would you introduce yourself? So this is
Jesus Hernandez.
Jesus Hernandez.
And Bill Sinclair.
And Bill Sinclair, also with the Lowe's Home Improvement Store. And we wanted to acknowledge them this evening for their, and they're at the Home Improvement Store in Westgate Mall. I should make that specific about that. That Chad and Aaron Russo, who wasn't able to make it tonight, who's their human resources manager, contacted us regarding their interest in making some improvements through their annual Heroes Community Improvement Project. And we recommended, Mr. Thomas, Michael Thomas, recommended the Goddard Alternative School. And so the Lowe staff took quite a bit of time planning the project, and which they completed on August 25th. I think, did it take longer than that, or just that one day?
Just one day.
Just that one day. So a large team of Lowe's employees, all volunteer, was very moving to me, came out and on their own time, without pay, planting new shrubs, mulching the front entrance to the school, repaired broken concrete, installed new pavers, repaired broken fencing in the schoolyard, installed a new seating area and a scoreboard for sports, and they installed and raised garden beds for the students to plant and grow fresh vegetables. So we really greatly appreciate Lowe's volunteers, their materials and supplies, which were significant, generously donated to this much-needed project at the Goddard School. The project was completed in time to welcome the Goddard students to start the school year, and the new aesthetic appeal of the school is especially important for this population of our special needs students. So we wanted to request the acknowledgement of the of this contribution, important contribution to the system.
So again, I have been up here doing the improvements, and this is your second year where we start school, we go to, you know, one of our schools and see a beautification project, and I couldn't agree more. Then when we have partners, business partners, it says a lot to the community. It says that you care, and most importantly, you care about kids. You know, hopefully those are your future workers. So we can't thank you enough, you know, and I know volunteering makes everybody happy. When I've gone out there and see the people working in volunteer projects, you know, people are really, it feels good inside to give of yourself, to do something that benefits so many for so many years to come. So we have a certificate. Could I read it, please?
Go ahead, Superintendent.
This certificate is presented in grateful recognition to the employee volunteers from the Lowe's Home Improvement Store, Westgate Mall, involved in the Goddard Alternative School Beautification and Vegetable Garden Project. We sincerely appreciate the commitment of the Lowe's volunteers and the generously donated materials and supplies needed to complete this much-needed school site revitalization project. Thank you, Lowe's Heroes Project. Please join me and the mayor. Karen, please join us.
Thank you very much.
Yes, I'm sorry, I don't have a hand.
Thank you very much.
Give me back your seat. Can we take a picture? Thank you so much.
Everybody in there?
Thank you.
Yeah, Karen, let's get
I must
you.
Show shop at Lowe's a lot because you look familiar to me.
Yeah.
That's good.
That's a good thing.
Want to jump in? Okay.
Thank you very much, sincerely.
Thank you.
Appreciate it. Take the next one.
I have one item, Superintendent, if I could jump in.
So guys, before they go, just give them a quick free commercial. We bought all our flowers at Lowe's this year. Great prices. They all did extremely well. We're coming back next year.
Thank you.
All right? We wanted to receive a note from the principal at the Raymond School, Carol McGrath. Who shared with us that school committee member Mr. Sullivan made a very generous donation of school supplies to the school and asked me if we would please recognize that here during our meeting. So Tim, thank you very much for your contribution to the children at the Raymond School.
You're welcome.
All right, thank you.
And Mr. Sullivan, I think Deputy Superintendent Thomas needs to get you a plaque.
Oh, yeah. That's right, yeah.
Budgets are tough. So on another happy note, I am so pleased, and as we have new administrative appointments in Brockton, to be able to hire from within because of the caliber of the teachers and administrators that we have here in Brockton, I think is always something special to all of us. So tonight I'd like to talk about publicly two of those appointments. The first one is our new principal taking over for Kevin Caro, who is our new athletic director here at Brockton High School. We are so pleased to announce to you that our former assistant principal, new principal at South Middle School, is Joseph Pomfret. I'd like to invite Mr. Pomfret, would you like to come up?
Surprise! Did I get the job, or is this the third?
No, you're all set. But would you like to share with us South Middle School? And I know you're excited about this leadership.
No, I appreciate it. Thank you very much. And, you know, as I came in here today, I saw Dr. Tarazi over there. And, you know, I just wanted him to know that during one of my interviews, you know, I mentioned his name and, you know, Darlene Campbell, Kevin Caro, Barbara Lovell. You know, I really paid attention to a lot of leaders ahead of me, and you know, I put a lot of their wisdom and words and philosophies into place, and you know, it all really came down to every decision you make has to answer the number one question, which is it best for the kids? And if it doesn't answer that question, then it doesn't get done. So I think that's what got me here, and I appreciate it, and I appreciate the chance, and I'll do my best. All right, thank you.
Thank you, Jeff. And another administrative appointment, we have a new position in the district. It's called the Director of Business, Instructional Technology, and Career Education. And that title probably would have scared off most people. Those are large areas, especially in the growing district. And quite honestly, when this name was brought forward, I was very pleased because I've watched the line of work of Mr. Kevin DuPont, our assistant dean in the Yellow House at Brockton High School. I've watched it for a long time. As a new superintendent, I went to him early on to talk about Infinite Campus, Parent Portal. He was always available to step in, to share his advice and his administrative talents. And I'm very, very pleased that he will be stepping into this new role, and it is a new role for our district. It is enhancing what's happening technology-wise for all the students in the Brockton Public Schools. We all know what's happening with our high-stakes testing coming on board, very soon online testing, and instructional technology or digital literacy is paramount in this district as we move forward. So I'd like to invite Kevin down. If you'd like to also say a few words, please join me in congratulating Kevin DuPont.
Thank you so much. I didn't know I was supposed to speak. I would prepare a speech. No, it's fine. Please. Just the first thing, I want to say thank you to everyone. I've always said this. There's something about Brockton. It was back in 2004 when I was hired in Brockton, and it was something about it. Like, I actually had other opportunities, but it was something about coming here. And honestly, I can't think of all the mentors that I've had along the way. It really is a great place, and it makes every day worth coming to school. I don't miss many days because, honestly, I do enjoy my job. All my jobs, from teaching, from floor teaching to assistant dean, all of them. Because the hard work that we do here is unbelievable. All the challenges that we face, but we just keep on going, which is great. So I look forward to this new opportunity. The job title is huge, not as big as Ethan's, but it's pretty close. So I'm looking forward to that opportunity. I've already kind of started it, and so I want to thank you all enough, and then feel free to contact me with any questions or concerns. Thank you.
So let me jump right into our October 1st report. You know how critical that is in a system like Brockton. We get 80% of our funding from the state. That's part of our foundation formula. Each year, we look at our district, and I will tell you, you know, many districts demographically are losing students. They're talking about a number of ways that they're going to survive, and we are a large district. I will tell you that our number last year was 17,383 on October 1st. This year we are down. We're down by only, and I'm going to say only, 39 students. And that's a testament that to the work that continues to be done. People choose the Brockton Public Schools, and you know, we're very pleased, and we're very pleased, you know, to have all our children in the Brockton Public Schools, and we'll continue to work very hard to earn the trust of parents in our community with entrusting their children to us. But again, that is a critical number for us. We'll continue to look at, and I think all of you know, that October 1st is just the beginning. The numbers don't stop here. As we go through the year, many times we have, you know, an additional 100, 200, 300, even at some points 400 additional youngsters by the time school ends when June comes. And we continue to be able to provide the resources on a very tight budget, and you know, we'll continue to look at every opportunity for our children, every grant opportunity, making sure that we continue to have discussions with our legislative delegation, making sure the mayor and I, you know, it isn't just a budget season. We continue to have discussions, you know, certainly each week, about, you know, what is happening with the budget. And I do appreciate, you know, that working relationship. And as Kim Gibson said to us, one of the things we do well is we are collaborative. I always have faith in, no matter what we're dealing with, and sometimes we're dealing with difficult situations, but I have faith in every one of you, certainly in the mayor and our elected officials, that we will come and do the best that we can for our students. So October 1st is just one thing in the foundation budget formula, and we will work very hard for all of you.
But that number, I think, if you reflect the students lost to the charter, we would have actually been on a game.
Mayor makes a good point, and the next thing on my agenda item is the charter school. And as I told you, and we will, I wanted October 1st to come, I will have every week, similar to the budget barometer, letting you know. It's critical now after October 1st to show you the students that come and go from the Brockton Public Schools. So the mayor makes a good point that right now our number stands, I think it's about 220, give or take, I'll have to get a more accurate number, of students that the Brockton Public Schools has lost to this charter school. I still don't see kids clamoring to go there. I'm not seeing, you know, children leaving the Brockton Public Schools in large numbers. I think that's a testament when you figure in losing about 220 students and only being down 39 students, the number of students that we continue to have, and it is growing in the schools. As far as a charter school update, I have had conversations with the charter school. I will continue to open the doors to communications as it involves our students in areas where we do have common interests, our special education students, if there's changes in placements. We will continue to have those conversations in the best interest of all of our students. I will report to you as we go in now. I think it's critical for you to hear on a regular basis what is happening with the charter as to how it affects the Brockton Public Schools. I'm not sure I've said this publicly, but we did have a recent charter application that has been denied going forward. There was another charter on our doorsteps, a group from Long Beach, California. Once again, I had taken a look at that application. Certainly wasn't a school that we would support in the Brockton Public Schools. I felt it was missing a lot of elements with the type and the needs of our students in Brockton. So the commissioner and his team saw the wisdom of not recommending that this application even go forward at this time. It involved Brockton, Avon, and Stoughton. I've spoken to the superintendents in the other districts, and we are all very pleased that this is not going forward. I also want to bring up the ballot initiatives, and I want to bring to everybody's attention the books that I believe registered voters have received during the past month. And this is critical for people to educate themselves on information for voters. I don't know about you, but these questions get longer and lengthier, and you're trying to figure out what's in the best interest of our families and our children. And I'm not here to get into a political debate. What I will tell you is last evening, myself, Tom Minicello, Mark DiAgostino, we were able to see a presentation by a number of our legislative delegation, Representative Claire Cronin, Representative Jerry Cassidy, and Senator Mike Brady. And it was about the question number four, it's the legalization of marijuana. I think it's critical that as parents and community members, that we read about that impact on our community. And one of the things that our representatives have decided to do, we probably had about 50 parents out last evening at the Hancock School. And what we are going to do is have a second presentation. It is worth it. We're going to get a Connect Ed call out there. We're hoping to have members of our bilingual community out there. We will have interpreters because I think it's important for all of us to get out there and not to wait till after November 8th to make our decisions on how we want to protect our children and our community. So please read up on it. Please make every effort to attend the session that will be coming up. And also, you do have the question on the charter expansion of charter schools, and that is question number two. As your superintendent, I have spoken about length, about the original intent of a charter school. When that came in back in 1993, along with ed reform, the idea at the time was that the charter schools, I think 25 were approved throughout the state to share best practices. They were supposed to be an incubator to talk about things that we do now without thinking, extended learning time. Many of those best practices that Brockton's been doing for a long time, extended time during the summer. We've been doing that since 1999. Many of you that are around as long as I have joined me in knowing that many of these best practices, we didn't need anybody to show us how to do it. We've done it. So the intent back in with ed reform in 1993 is truly not the intent now. I ask people to refer to this literature and make sure, again, that you're making decisions to support your public school system in making sure that you have, my concern is representation. You know, we sit as a committee, as a body, that looks at the spending of public dollars. It is not the same. It is not, it's apples and oranges as far as what's required of a public school district and a charter school, public school district. So please read up on this. Make sure November 8th is quickly approaching and make sure that you are educated as a voter, you know, to make your choices.
And, one quick comment.
Oh, please, Mayor.
Superintendent covered all, but I think it's important for people to know as we look at our budget struggles, we lost about $6 million in Chapter 70 funding this year to tuitions being paid outside the school district. So if anyone does not think the advertising that's being done by the Yes on Four people is so misleading, I don't know how they're even getting away with it, because they're confusing people with the word public school. They're not differentiating clearly between charter schools. They're not differentiating between a for-profit group like New Heights targeting an urban school district to take money out of our budget to put into a school that will put money in their pockets, and that's what it comes down to. So I would just encourage people to really not fall for the advertising and really do your research and look and see what these issues are. They're not trying to put for-profit charter schools in Wellesley or Cohasset. They're targeting our budget, our kids, our numbers, and it's not right, and it will get a lot worse if this cap is taken off the charters. You know, we're fighting hard now against what we're fighting, and I think it's one thing, as an example with Kim up here earlier, I think we've shown that there, while we sometimes may disagree on some things philosophically, I think we have been able to identify issues that we know are in the best interest of our kids and work together on those. So whether it's safety and security, or it's trying to secure adequate funding, you know, we do need to work together collaboratively on those, and I would encourage people to educate their friends and relatives and registered voters as to what this question is really about and how it impacts a city like Brockton. Thank you.
Thank you. And I'm going to move on again to good news. So this is good news, bad news kind of a night. So this is good news. So the good news is we received our accountability information, I believe it was last Monday at 4:30 p.m. We were very pleased, and I want to remind everybody that when you hear us talk about inadequate state funding formula that we have seen causing larger class sizes than we would like, decreasing in some programs, academic supports with grants that we're slowly seeing decrease, you know, materials and supplies are stretched. With all of those things happening, with our information coming in on accountability, I am so pleased to tell our public that we continue to show improvement. We continue to have more level one schools than we have ever had in the history of the Brockton Public Schools, that being the highest level, showing student growth. And this is a testament, and I know we have many teachers out here this evening, many administrators that come to work, that pull together, that make sure that there are no excuses for making sure your children get the things that they need, making sure that you're able to service, whether a class size of 20 would be more appropriate for you being able to give children individual attention. I walk into those classes, sometimes they're 25, I've seen them up to 30, and I've seen them beyond that. And the teaching is excellent, that instruction, that dedication to our students continue, and it shows when I can sit here and tell you that Brockton High School is a level one school in the state of Massachusetts. So we're very, very pleased for that. We also welcome North Middle School as one of our level one schools, both of them joining the East Middle School and the Kennedy Elementary School from last year. You have four level one schools. You have numbers of level two schools. And while we still do have some level three schools, we have shown improvement. I'm just going to call out a couple, and I do want you to know that Dr. Cancel will be doing a much larger presentation, if not the end of the month, early November. I know he continues to work to make sure that he's able to provide the information and to share with you some schools that we continue to need to support. But we're very, very pleased to talk about, I know the Raymond School, and that was a school that we reconfigured a couple of years ago. We have a new kindergarten program in there. We've had new programs, new academic supports. I want to congratulate Deputy Superintendent Barry and her Office of Teaching and Learning. You know, June Saber McGuire, our executive director, who continues to work with those schools that showed improvement. Also, the Hancock School, you know, has shown some improvement this year that is worth a call out, and there are many more. So, you know, we will have that presentation to you sooner than later, and we'll be able to have some discussion about those areas that are concerning and those areas that we can celebrate and continue to make sure we have those kinds of academic supports in place. To make sure that our schools continue along the path they're continuing. So I hope that Brockton High School, when Principal Wolder announced that to you early last week, I'm sure a big cheer went up at the high school, and that's a testament to all of the hard work, and I'd like you to share that with the students back at Brockton High. I hope to be able to do that sooner than later also with that, but thank you for all of your hard work. And next on the agenda, and this is probably one of my favorite presentations, and this is one that I used to do as Director of Community Schools. When you think of the school ending, and you go to a lot of communities, when that last day of school comes, the schools are closed for the summer. that is not the case in Brockton. It's not the case when you talk about a number of academic programs, when you talk about fund programs, when you talk about collaborations with a lot of our community agencies to make sure that whatever our kids could possibly want, whether it's swimming, whether it's recreation, whether it's, you know, additional academic support beyond the school year, all of that is here in Brockton. So I'm going to let the new director of community schools, Laurie Silva, share with us what the past summer was like.
And it holds me near and dear to be able to take over after Kathy Smith did, and then Maxine Richardson. We were all in that office for quite a few years together, so it's wonderful to be back there in this role. I'm very pleased to be able to be presenting to you tonight. The summertime, as the superintendent had mentioned, for the community schools office is extremely busy. The school year is busy, yes, but the summer is a heightened level of activities that occur for not only our students and children of the Brockton community, but also for adults. So you'll hear a little bit about youth-centered programming. Some of it will be academically focused, some of it will be enrichment focused, and then the same thing for adults. We'll cover that as well. And maybe not. There we go. All right, so a program near and dear, Summer of Work and Learning, and Kevin DePonte can attest to that. He's been involved with that for quite a few years now, and we're going to be sad to see him not involved in it from the future moving forward with his new role. But the Summer of Work and Learning is a program that has focused intently on servicing our high school student populations with work internship programs. So this past year, we had different teams. T-shirt, mural, we worked at the Davis School, concession stands, we did some community-based projects. But basically what happens is it's a group of youth that receive MCAS supports in a very structured setting where they're gaining workforce development experiences, and they have tutoring that's done around that. So it's been 22 years, as we had mentioned, as you can see right there. So 22 years that it's been in the system that we've offered. As the superintendent mentioned, there are some programs that have lost funding, and unfortunately, this is one of those programs that has lost funding. The state is no longer going to be funding this initiative. Now, not this past summer, but the summer before that, it happened then as well through 9C cuts. And as a district and as a community, we were able to collaboratively work together and gander enough funding that we're able to fund a hybrid function of it. And we will continue to do so in this community, because after 22 years, we're not going to let this go. And these are some of the photos that you can see. We had some of the activities that those high school students did were amazing for the community presence that occurred throughout the summer months. Summer Leaders. We partnered with the Y on this, and it was a wonderful program for some of our rising ninth graders. So in other words, the eighth graders going on to the ninth grade, that we knew in advance that they were probably going to experience some challenges. So we created a program that was specifically geared to heightening their levels of not only their academic development, but also the development for leadership. So they became mentors or camp leaders for younger students, really heightened their awareness and their success rate for being able to move into the ninth grade when we knew full well that we're probably going to have some challenges. Power Scholars. It used to be the Summer Success Program, and again, this was another partnership with the Y. So what we really did was we focused on a group of students between the grades of second grade to fifth grade. We elongated the number of hours that they received, so the dosage was much higher than what had ever been done before. But we really focused on activities that were going to heighten not only their academic supports, but also their social emotional. So we were really looking at the whole child in this program. And these are some of their photo captions. Great time, very actively engaged students and staff. this was our program for our middle school. Engineering is everywhere, and it's elementary. And it was done in partnership with the Museum of Science in Boston. Again, really capturing the STEM focus, which is just so heavy now for all of our students in all of our grades. So we had a total of 66 students that were engaged in this, and they had a fairly high dosage of programming opportunities as well, with 64 hours, and they were involved in real-world programming. So as you can see, is that photo there, the kids were actively doing experiments. They were learning while they were playing, per se, in what they were engaged in. We had a few English language learner programs, and the director of bilingual ed, Kelly Jones, I know would be more than willing to offer increased input with regards to two of these programs. But the first one was for our elementary grades, K through 5, the Summer Immigrant Student Science Program. Both of our programs for the middle school as well as the elementary and high school all focused on science. And basically the major focus on all of these three programs was embedding in the content area of science in English, the language development. So the students were not only engaged in learning on how to gain expertise in science, English development, but also in learning the language, which was huge. And I don't know off the top of my head, to be honest with you, with the elementary program, but I do know data-wise with the middle school and the high school level, because I did recently do a report to the state, we did have marked gains from the beginning of the program to the end of the program between pre and post testing. So great successes. And then there's more. So the summer school and rising ninth, now we're getting into more fee-based programs here. The prior programs that I mentioned were all grant-funded programs, so there were no fees attached for student attendance. So the programs that we're going to be speaking of now are more fee-based programs, but again, essential and important programs nonetheless. So summer school and the Rising Ninth, they're basically for programs that students are required to take because they were not able to meet course content grade level requirements for moving on. So we did have programs for students in grade 9 through 12, as well as that Rising Ninth, which was the eighth grade is going on to the ninth grade. There was a great deal of education brought forward for bilingual students. And as I had mentioned, that Rising Ninth program was a wonderful gift for students that we knew were going to have challenges. Driver's Ed is one of those programs that continues to be at the forefront of what is offered through through the community schools office, and always will be, would be my sense, to be honest with you. Get Ready Sports. This is a huge hit for students. As you can see, we had 816 students enrolled. It's a morning program, and there's a myriad of sports activities that are offered. So it's a huge success. The students that are enrolled in it have a wonderful time, and I'm sure the parents are very pleased with it as well, because the students go home and their children are tired. And then Boxer Camp is an extension of Get Ready, and it's offered for students who want to do an afternoon component as well, and for that we did have 134 students enrolled. Raise Up Basketball. This is an unbelievable undertaking, and there's a lot of students that are enrolled in it as well. And it's it offers them the fundamentals of basketball, which, as most of us know, is a huge sport activity that's accepted and willingly embraced in the community of Brockton. Junior Boxer Camp, we had a large enrollment there as well. And this is only available to youth who participate in some of the morning programs that I had mentioned earlier. And the activities that are included in Junior Boxer Camp, are arts and crafts, the sports, and some of the swimming activities. aquatics. We have aquatics for both youth and adult. And what I should mention in the youth aquatics, which isn't really shown on this bulletin as well or this page, is that we do offer for youth who want to become lifeguards, but there is a component where we do offer lifeguard classes as well. So that is another aspect that isn't actually reflected in this slide. And then for adults, there's plenty that are offered for adults, and those actually all continue in the school year as well. Act one, scene one. This is phenomenal. The students have a great opportunity to actively engage in being a theater production member. And this year, it was based on the Jungle Book from Disney, and based on the book by Mr. Kipling. So it was a wonderful activity. Two nights that they have productions, very affordable for people and families to attend and engage in the production. Now, we have programming that pretty much fits a wide variety of ages for students. So for our younger ones, there's the Kiddie Fun Camp, which is more of the arts and crafts and storytelling. You know, the wonderful, nice exposures, the warm and fuzzy exposures for students. Cooperative sports and games for the younger ones, too. And I always love visiting these programs, especially when they're first starting up, because you get to see all the tears. It's like their first, you know, getting used to this. For many of the students, it's their first exposure from breaking away from mom or dad and being involved in a social activity. So you do get to see the tears, and then as the program evolves and develops, you know, they're just so ecstatic and so happy to be there. So it's wonderful to see. And then we have the pre-K and K fun camp, which is more of the typical camp activities that you would expect to see. But what's so special about this program is you have your typically developing peers that are also interacting with youth with disabilities. Then for our older youth from grades 2 to 7, there's Reader's Theater, which is a great exposure to literature and the arts. Who Wants to Be a Millionaire, which really focuses upon math. And then the Mini Day Fun Camp, which is very similar for our younger ones, but more geared for the older students as far as what they're exposed to. Smart Start Extended Day pretty much runs all year round. It really is a phenomenal production. During the summer, which is different from the school year, we actually do go up from up to grade 7. So we do enroll students of the higher grades. Normally during the school year, it's only up to grades 5. But during the summer, we fully recognize and respect that some parents and some students of the upper grade levels really need to have more supports and should not be in an unstructured program during the summer months. So therefore, we do enroll the upper grades as well. And then one of the other things that we do, not only to support the youth, but also to support the community schools programming, is we do enroll the grades 5 through 7 students who are in extended day in the Get Ready program so that they have that release of their energies, and it breaks up from being in a program for many of them from 7 o'clock in the morning to 6 o'clock in the evening. So, equity and education for all, yes. We strive to do that constantly in the Brockton Community Schools office, but not only for students, but for adults as well. So thank you. I really appreciate your time. I'll gladly entertain any questions or any comments that people may have.
Ms. Plant.
To the program that you do where students can earn credits.
Yes.
That's a paying program, or?
Yes, it is. That's the traditional summer school, which we've done for a very long time in the district.
Okay. That's, I was wondering if it was different than the summer school program, but that
no,
is the summer
it is.
School
No, it is the summer school program.
Okay. Thank you.
You're welcome. Thank you. It's been a pleasure. Thank you.
It's a good thing there's nothing for kids to do during the summer, huh?
The next item on the agenda is the ratification of the Memorandum of Agreement between the Brockton School Committee and the Administrative Assistants, the IBAA TEA Association.
Okay. Do we have a, is there a report or anything? We're just taking a vote.
Tom, want to give me a little guidance on this? Is there any kind of a report or statement or just taking a vote on the ratified contract?
Mr. Sullivan, chair
of that. Or was Judy? Okay. Do you want to report in, I guess, on the work of the subcommittee?
And we also have Mr. Beals here also, who sat in from the associate director from HR, if you'd like him to answer any questions.
I mean, we met and had, you know, did you want to say something?
Maybe, Matt, just a quick overview, just so the public has just a general idea of what it is the committee is voting on, I think would be fair.
Certainly.
Good evening, everyone. What we're going to vote on tonight is the Memorandum of Agreement. It's going to include a couple of things. One is a three-year comprehensive contract that we negotiated successfully with our Administrative Assistance Union, and also what it will do is to integrate some technology positions into the union. So that, in a nutshell, is essentially what we're going to vote on tonight. I could answer any specific questions you may have regarding this contract.
There's no questions. We can attend by no question, Mr. D'Agostino.
Sorry, okay. Purely out of curiosity, the technology positions that you decided to incorporate into the union, was there a particular rationale or reason for that?
Well, essentially, the premise that the union brought forward is that the union is called the IBAA&T, and the T stands for the Technology Education Assistance. Help me out here. but essentially, it was the union's premise that these positions all along belonged as a part of the membership. The group voted collectively to join a union, and Janet and her gang decided to...
We're not a gang. I want to make that very clear. We are not a gang.
I, of course, use that figuratively, but essentially,
thank you.
But we brought the group in.
Yes, and the reason they were brought in was because they were actually part of our recognition clause, and over the years we had two members already from the technical team. We brought in the rest of them. They were apparently forgotten, so they made petition to join a union and realized that the Mass Department of Labor Relations said, look, you've got two people that are already part of a union, you belong with them. So that's why they came with us. We had to integrate them into our union.
I think it's worth to mention, when you look at and we talk about digital literacy and we talk about, you know, certainly what's coming for all our students and teachers, that department continues to grow.
Yes. Yep. They're not a gang either.
No. we anticipate those numbers rising. Right.
They're a virtual gang.
So I sat there for many nights. I want to thank school committee members. Our negotiation went on, you know, certainly throughout the summer. I know there was a lot of hard work on both sides, you know, coming to an agreement, and certainly during a very difficult budget. So I thank you for your collaborative efforts and working as hard as you did, school committee, and certainly the administrative assistants.
Absolutely. Thank you.
Thank you.
Have to vote.
Okay. How about a motion to approve? Motion's been made by Mr. Gormley. Second?
Second.
Motion's been made and properly seconded. All members in favor of ratifying the agreement as presented? Approved unanimously.
Okay. And items to refer to subcommittee, I believe we have that work going on. We're trying to, because there are so many items that we continue to set up our meetings. I think we want to continue to use our Tuesday nights that are non-school committee nights. I know I've asked Wanda to set up a list so we can take a look at things from looking at facilities, looking at our policy manual review. So we certainly have been looking at these meetings. We'll be setting up a schedule and getting those dates out to you.
Okay. Any specific requests from school committee members regarding subcommittees?
Meeting. Just so the committee's aware, tomorrow night at 5:30 at the Arnone Theater, there's a facilities subcommittee meeting.
Right. I don't believe there is. Is it tomorrow night? Oh, on the. Okay.
So.
Right. It's not a committee at all.
I think I might not have that. Tomorrow night.
There's also a non-certified negotiation at 6 p.m. apparently at Central. Okay.
So do we have a facilities meeting posted?
Yes.
Okay. 5:30 tomorrow night. Okay.
Okay.
I can try to come by. Okay.
And I'd like to take, at this point here, I want to thank the people that came tonight that spoke at the hearing of visitors. I do want to say that last week I was very difficult because, quite honestly, when you think about the good news of our Brockton High academic status, we were very pleased to share it with our staff and our students, and we're looking forward to celebrating. And one of the things that I will say, when you look at what happened, it was a very small number of students, although it was quite serious when there is any kind of a disruption in a high school as large as 4,300 youngsters every day coming in, coming out, attending classes, you know, enjoying, you know, socializing and time with their friends, you know, after school activities. And on, you know, 99% of the days, certainly students are there for the right reasons, and it is a wonderful place to be. Many of us were very disappointed by these actions, but these are a couple of things that I would like to share with the community. When you talk about students and you talk about changes that were brought up about Chapter 222, a change in the law back in July of 2014, the genesis of some of these changes were communities looking at themselves, and many of these are our larger communities. I remember hearing some of the elected officials from the Boston Public Schools talking about making sure that we did not have throwaway students. Nobody wants to see a pipeline to prison. Everybody in this community would attest to the fact that we want all our children to succeed, to have an opportunity to get that credential, that high school diploma, to go on to college and career. And kids don't always make the best choices. These are young people, ages 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, and some even older in our public school and in our very large high school. When the law change came about 2 years ago with Chapter 222, many of us were not pleased. Because in Brockton, we actually have opportunities for kids that don't make it at a 4,300 student high school. We're not a small high school. We don't have 800 students in our high school or smaller. I want you to think about that number. And when you talk about alternative pathways, I counted the other day, and we continue to grow based on the needs of our community, 7 alternative pathways. We have collaborations with colleges. We have an evening program that the mayor and I talked about graduating 200 students back during the summer. You know, over 950 students at Brockton High School graduate every year, go on to wonderful colleges. We have the Keith Center, the Frederick Douglass Academy. For those students that have behaviors where they cannot and do not belong at Brockton High School. Now, Chapter 222, the teacher that spoke before you tonight is correct. I'm not blaming everything on Chapter 222. There are some things that we are looking at as a district, but I want to make it very clear to parents in the community that if there are students that have behaviors that actually need to have them removed from our high school, there are other opportunities for them. And we will do everything we can to try to change a behavior. But it becomes very difficult when you talk about, you hear me talk about teachers, and they're teaching with 35 students in a classroom, 26 students in a classroom. You know, their time is taken up with making sure that they are able to instruct, develop relationships. And when you walk around Brockton High School, the mayor and I were there, and a number of school committee members joined us this past Monday. I was there again today. There are wonderful things happening. We were in and out of 20 classrooms. I had the opportunity to talk to teachers. And this is a time, and I thank Kim Gibson and the Brockton Education Association. I look forward to working with her and thinking about ways that we can become a better school. I've been talking to Principal Wolder, and she and I have certainly been talking for the past 2 years about looking district-wide and beginning at the high school and looking at what's called a code of conduct, that the community comes together and we all decide what we want for our children in school every day. And certainly what we saw with some of the behaviors on Thursday are not what we want to see in our schools. And there needs to be consequences for behavior that frankly is unacceptable. And that doesn't mean that we have throwaway students. But I am here to tell you, can I guarantee you 100%? It doesn't matter where any of us go nowadays, our safety is nothing, none of us take that for granted anymore. But what happened, what came into our school, was squabbles in the neighborhood. We are a microcosm of what goes on in society. And yet, we don't push back when it comes to making sure our children are fed, making sure our children have all of the activities that we talk about, academic supports, you know, opportunities to become those young adults that succeed. We do it very well, and we do it well every single day in the Brockton Public Schools, and no more so than in the Brockton at Brockton High School. That doesn't mean that there aren't things that we need to take a look at, that we need to improve. So we've been talking about a code of conduct, you know, a discipline code that we can all accept that doesn't run afoul of the law, but also makes it clear that it isn't about throwaway kids. There are opportunities for students in the Brockton Public Schools. I would at this point like to ask our principal, Sharon Wolder, to come up. I hope Sharon is still here. Sharon, yep. And talk about, again, for something that should have been a week of celebration, many of us were disappointed. We will have that opportunity again in the near future because I can assure you good things are happening at Brockton High, but we are willing to sit down and correct, and I thank everybody that will be involved in making sure that we provide the best education possible for our students and our families, and I'm asking them to join us and please help us to continue these efforts.
Good evening. A couple weeks ago, I came and I told you we had the most successful opening that we could have had under the conditions that we were given, and we did, and we have continued to work diligently with our students to make sure that they continue to have the best education possible because, yes, we are a level one school. We're a level one school because of the academics of our students. We're a level one school because we have a number of students who are very difficult to educate at times that we don't give up on, that we have made some changes in the way that we do things, and it doesn't feel the way it used to. Trust me, I know I've held a number of positions in this school over the last 22 years, and the change in the law was probably one of the toughest because we had to figure out how do we make sure when kids are able to return, when kids are at the school, when the things that we used to address in a different way, we now have to address in a new way, in a way that's more about intervention than it is about suspension, and it has challenged us greatly. However, most of our students come. They might have a little edge and a little attitude sometimes, no doubt. I was told yesterday, ma'am, you don't have to give me that much attitude, and I said, oh. Maybe I have an attitude too, but we had a nice conversation, me and the young man, and he understood my attitude because ultimately it really is about the safety of the school. And there's not anybody who probably spends more time there than I do. There's not anybody who probably loses more sleep over that place than I do. but I'm committed to being there and working very hard with our faculty and our students because we are a nationally recognized school. We take the toughest kids to educate and do an incredible job with them. Does it make us happy every day when it's tough? Not at all. But it doesn't mean that we don't get together and that we don't work together. We might disagree, but we do the work. And you now understand the challenges that I've talked about for quite a while. Our student population continues to increase. They are coming to us, many of them with traumas. Many of them have had some really tough lives. And as I told our faculty in a message that I sent to them before school started, we are more richly diverse and economically poor. And we are more challenged in what we have to do to educate our kids. And with those challenges, we don't give up. We talk about Boxer Pride, we live it every day. And so do most of our students. However, on Thursday at lunchtime, and believe it or not, our Thursday was an hour and a half of just one thing after another, and I have to give a lot of credit to our faculty members who were out and about and who were stepping in and helping. They were there. I have to give a lot of credit to our school police officers who joined us when they, most of the time, they know when to get involved and they know when to not be involved. And when we called for them, they were there. And when we asked students to back off, many of them did. We also live in a time where social media has us chasing ghosts sometimes, or clowns. But we know that our kids believe it because they saw it on social media. We also know that our parents sometimes believe it because they saw it on social media. And so we find ourselves oftentimes looking into things and spending our wills and doing a lot of work that people don't see to make sure that our school remains safe. And for those students who behaved in a way that when the adults intervened and asked them to stop, did not stop, they were arrested. And I stand on that. And I know there are some people who think kids should not be arrested in a school, but I have 4,287 children and 500 adults every day that I need to do the best that I can to keep them safe. And so they were arrested, and we are dealing with it. And we are dealing with it within the law because that's what we do. And it doesn't mean that we'll never see them again at Brockton High School. It simply means that within the law, we will deal with it, and we will ensure that even those students continue to get an education, because that's what we do. And by the way, yes, we are level one.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Any questions for the principal while we have her up here?
Right. There were some questions about the rules.
These are the rules, and you work on some of these rules, and the school committee approves the rules. And one of the rules that I asked Mrs. Smith about was the cell phone rule. Shortly after I left, it had changed. that was around 2012. And one of the things I asked Mrs. Smith was the social media aspect of this whole thing and the texting involved. I think it added, and you acknowledge it too, I think that we need to look at that policy again and make sure that everybody's on the same page. I've seen it at my school where these things can blow up. The clowns is the most recent example. And it just adds fuel to the fire. And, you know, I'm guilty of texting my daughter in school. It's here. And if anybody has any questions, it's here. This is one of the few things that we have control of. We control the budget, we control policy, we evaluate the superintendent. Those are our three main things. I think that we do need to look at that, and we need to look at some other things that are in this, and we need to incorporate some things that are more restorative. And I started a conversation with Mrs. Smith about it. I'm sure she'll inform you some of the things that we've done in my school in Boston that are working pretty well. It's one of the few things that I think that we're getting right that Brockton isn't. So I just wanted to point that out, in that if anybody on the staff or administration has any confusion about what the rules are in the school, it's right here. We all have a copy of it.
Well, you know, again, let me answer that. You know, we have had conversation, and Principal Wolder and I had also been having conversation and connecting with a district similar to ours out of state. I had listened to them talk about a code of conduct that I spoke about earlier, and you're clearly right. I mean, this is our policy. This is our handbook for parents, and I also would ask you to take a look at our handbook. But in looking at a code of conduct, because of some of the changes that we have, whether we call it restorative justice, you know, there needs to be some dialogue. And we're certainly willing. I've talked to, at this point, two consultants, one that you referred to me, Mr. Gormley. And before any of this happened, Principal Wolder and I were setting up an appointment to have a conversation, which isn't just about Brockton High in the end. It really is a code of conduct for our whole district. What we looked at in the district I looked at was Syracuse. It probably has about 23,000 students. In the middle of our setting up an arrangement to meet with the superintendent, she moved to another district in North Carolina. Hence the conversation with a consultant, you know, to come and to talk to us, which he is going to have a phone conversation next week. We're going to spend about 90 minutes talking about how you bring a community together, how you make sure that things, especially when you're talking 4,300 students in the largest high school east of the Mississippi, you know, how we look at some of those practices to make sure it's consistent throughout the houses, to make sure that we're dealing with kids in a way that, as Principal Wolder said, you know, we need to change some behavior sometimes. It's not about throwaway kids, and it's not about those kids that don't belong at Brockton High. Sometimes there are behaviors that get in the way, and it could be something as simple as, we talked about headphones, you know, we talked about cell phones. You talk about the you know, dress, the pulling up of pants, making sure that it sounds silly. But that's in this handbook. And those are things that I'm watching teachers address, and we need to be maybe a little more proactive, but it is something that has always been on our front burner, and I guarantee you that we will include many of you in those discussions, and obviously, you know, work to make sure we have the confidence of the staff, listen to some of their concerns, and talk about the things that are working and not working, and we will get better. We will get better.
Mr. Minichiello.
I had the good fortune of coming up to Brockton High the other day, and let me just tell you what I observed. I observed a staff that is totally committed to the building, to the kids, to each other. They were obviously upset and disappointed with what happened, but they all expressed a willingness to do what needs to be done, to support kids, a staff that loves this place, just like Mr. DuPont basically said earlier. You know, so I have no doubt that we have great people up here that just need to know what tools they have at their disposal. There needs to be, I think, more definition or explanation of how 222 works, because I think that there's ambiguity between what some people's opinion or interpretation is from person to person, and we need to do a better job of communicating that, and that's something that you know, we need to implement in terms of getting in a consultant or getting in one of our attorneys to basically have a uniform discussion with the staff so that everyone's clear on what can and can't be done and how to handle certain situations. But wonderful people up here, all committed. I also observed an administration all stepping up and just committed, again, to the kids, to the staff, to the building, to the public school system, and to the city, wanting to, you know, make sure that something like this never happens again. And it was just a lot of good people doing good work. I also witnessed, you know, the school police, Lieutenant Mills, his staff, you know, all there, you know, a presence, but, you know, always telling me that they know when to get involved and when not to get involved. They don't want to be, they want a school solution before a law enforcement solution, and they only step in when they feel that the situation is at a level that
people are going to get hurt, and that a situation is at a point where they need to get involved for the safety of students, staff, and themselves. So, and I also spoke to plenty of kids who, just like our student representative said, you know, this is not okay with them. They are not happy with the actions of a few, because this is a great school, level one school, and you know, I don't want anyone to think that there aren't great things happening here, because we all know there are wonderful things happening here. There's so many good kids, and 99.9% of those kids the other day when I was here were so polite, friendly. You know, they don't know who I am. I'm shooting the breeze with them, talking about different, you know, things, and you know, they just want to get an education and have a good time with their peers, and you know, move on to the next level of life. And you know, you can just see the spark in their eye, and these are just great kids, and they need a stable environment. They need, you know, they deserve an education, and they don't deserve the distraction. You know, so you know, we're all going to come together. This city's going to come together, and it's just you know, it's just a small blip, you know, unfortunately, in the history of the high school, but it too will pass, and I have every faith that we're going to work together and get it done, because we always do. You know, that's what Brockton does, and you know, together with the help of the teachers, the administration, the school committee, the mayor, I mean, you know, school police, we're going to get it done. It'll be fine. It'll work out. Believe me, it will work out, because I saw firsthand what this building is all about. You know, and it's a great place. It was a great place when we all went here, and it's a great place now. So you can't throw water on Brockton High.
And I know Principal Wilder has been communicating to the parents, making sure that they understand every step of the way what's happening. But the one thing I do want to make sure that the parents understand, when you bring up social media, when you bring up students texting, when you bring up the things that students do, make sure that you're watching what your children are involved in. Make sure that, again, you are vigilant as to what's happening. If at any time you have any concern, please, we have text a tip. I had good intentions of bringing the card with me this evening.
It's actually in the back of your handbook.
Oh, all right, great. Thank you for telling me that. I thought I looked at everything, but you're right. There is text a tip. And parents, make sure, you know, if there's information you need to share, this is anonymous. We will certainly, you know, act on things that we need to act on to make sure that the school is a safe place. But sharing information and communicating is really key. Being vigilant and watching what your children are up to, what the conversation is, making sure that their relationships are healthy relationships in the neighborhood, with their friends, you know, on the sports teams, all of the things kids take part in. That is really critical, because you're our partner in this educational journey of your child. So I know, Sharon, you've been communicating with parents. Thank you.
We actually had a school council meeting tonight. I left that to come to the finance meeting, and Mr. Perkins was there and shared with me some of the things that parents were concerned about. Obviously, budget, libraries, Chapter 222, all of those things that parents are questioning and wanting more information about, but very active group of people, so we're happy to have them on board. I also want to let you know that on Thursday, we actually have an in-service, which our student pointed out. In the first hour of that, we're working with the attorney to try to come and meet with the faculty to just kind of lay out really what happens, because people often think that if a student is suspended or sent to an alternative setting, they don't get to return, and that's inaccurate. They actually do. And so where people are saying, I thought this student was gone, they were, and they're back, and we are responsible for educating them. So she's going to help shed some light on the impact of the law in terms of the school, in terms of interventions versus suspensions and things like that, to hopefully help people understand the different roles that each of us play with that particular law. And yes, the handbook is there, and people do have access to it, and it is about a team of people, regardless of their role in the school, enforcing it together.
I should make a brief comment. So, first of all, I want to say that I listened to Mr. Bennett and Ms. Gibson very carefully earlier this evening. I think they both raised very fair points for us to take a good hard look at. Not saying I agree on everything, but I think there were some very queer, fair questions asked. So, you know, I'll share a little frustration. You know, the actions of 16 teenagers were in the Boston News for 3 days about, you know, negative stuff about Brockton High School. You know, 4,300 kids come here every day, study hard, participate in extracurricular activities, work part-time jobs, get good grades, and do a great job. And it's just really frustrating when a handful cause a perception to change over a vast majority who are doing great work. And a lot of kids here overcome substantial challenges, and they overcome them here with the support of the people who work here. So, you know, that good work doesn't stop. But what I have told people the last couple days is I'm not interested in excuses, don't have time for them. We need to work together on solutions because clearly we can do better. And I think we need to not lower the bar, we can do better. And so I think that this is an opportunity to take a step back, rethink the way we do some things, not be afraid to make changes, not be afraid to be self-critical, figure out how we intervene with kids before the fight breaks out, not after. Look at both short-term and long-term changes we can make. The school committee does have a role, and no one's more respectful of the superintendent's job and the principal's job than I am. They run the school and the school system. But policy does fall within the school committee, and so does the budget. And I think both of those things are factors that need to be looked at. And I think that, you know, the community has to be involved in this. We have to agree what the expectations are and how we're going to get there. Because I know last Thursday and Friday don't meet my expectations. I don't think they meet the expectations of anyone else. I think people who work here have a right to feel safe when they come to work, just like anyone that goes to work anywhere else. I think students do feel safe by and large, but if there are some questions being raised, we need to answer them and assure them that that's the way it is. I think the school police provide a very important role here, but discipline is enforced by teachers and administrators. The law is what's enforced by the school police, and we should only have very rare instances where we cross that line and the law is being broken and the school police have to intervene. But they need to be here in good numbers and well-trained and ready to respond if something does happen to protect the people that are here. So I think the committee will work closely with the administration around the policy handbook. And if there are things in there that are not going to change and need to be enforced differently, then we need to talk to the administration about that. And if there are things in here that the administration feels need to be changed policy-wise, we have to be receptive to that conversation as well. And while I acknowledge and I've mentioned the limitations that are imposed by 222, it can't be an excuse to not have a safe school, and it's not an excuse to not enforce discipline. And like a lot of things, I think maybe some of this, when we look at longer-term solutions, means looking back at kids before they get to the high school and instilling values and conduct and what's being expected of them before they even get here. I just think we all have a lot of work to do. It's not a time for finger pointing, it's a time for... So let's end on a high note. I want to share something very positive with you. For those of you that spend a lot of time up here at the high school campus, you know that the Rocky Marciano statue came 4 years ago, almost exactly to the day. And the Rocky statue was phase one of a project that we hoped would include the development of a park around the statue to make it more inviting, to make it a better place for people to come and visit, to be part of the whole thing, and to provide us an opportunity down the road to recognize other prominent Brocktonians that have contributed to the history and the future of the city. And it's been frustrating because we had made a commitment from day one that this was not going to be taxpayer dollars, that the money that had to be spent on the statue in the park, we had to raise privately. And it's not always easy to raise money privately nowadays. So it's taken a little bit longer than we'd hoped. We've had a couple false starts. But I want to share with you just great news that earlier today at City Hall, Roy Andrade, who is the owner and president of Everett's Auto Parts, made a $50,000 commitment to complete Champions Park. And he actually wrote us a check for $25,000 this morning of his own personal funds, and he made a commitment to raise the additional $25,000 himself personally to complete the project. And Friday evening at 6:30, prior to the football game, we're going to have a little groundbreaking ceremony at the statue before the game, so we hope you'll join us for that. And then at halftime of the game, we'll have a formal check presentation ceremony. I think we've got 2.5 minutes between when they blow the whistle and when the band starts. So it'll be quick, but it's important that when someone like this from the community steps up in a manner like this to do something that, you know, we talk about enhancing and changing the perception and the image of the city, this park on this campus is going to help do that. And a lot of other people have helped along the way, and we don't want to overlook any of them. Ross Messina from Messina Construction, Mr. Keene, who drew the plans, George Millette from Hawkeye Fence. We have the Bricklayers Union coming in to do volunteer labor. They started some today. They're going to be here tomorrow, so that by Friday night you'll actually see some of the brickwork going up. And I think it's going to be very exciting. So we'll get as much as we can get done this fall. It'll be completed sometime in the spring. And I just want to, on behalf of the city and in our school community, thank Mr. Andrade and his family for their very generous donation. Thank all the others that have been helping us along the way. It's taken some time. But what I told Mr. Andrade earlier today, why part of the reason I think this is so significant is that the Rocky Marciano story of 75 years ago is just as relevant to kids in the city today as it was then. And for the same reason Mr. Andrade's family came here from the Azores and worked hard and built a great company and a great future for their family. And certainly Rocky, you know, came here as the son of an Italian immigrant who worked in the shoe factories and earned himself a great future and great success and worldwide recognition. And I think that that story that that statue represents is just as relevant to kids who are coming here today from Cape Verde and Haiti and Latin America as it was to the people who came here 75, 80 years ago. So this is a really important project. I'm really excited that it's going to get completed. And so I hope that if you're able to be here for the football game Friday night, tough game. I won't say the halftime show may be the highlight of the evening. That's why we're doing the dedication right before the band plays. No one loves the football team more than I do. This is a tough game coming up this week. We hope that get here half an hour early, join us over at the statue for the ceremony with Mr. Andrade. Give him a nice round of applause at halftime because he deserves it. Thank you.
Good. Very good.
Anything else?
Nope. Good luck
Everybody
to our
good?
Football team. I believe
yes.
they can take
Go off. Boxes. All right. Meeting's adjourned. Thank you very much.